announcements. Okay, so these are the assignments. Assignment 3 is going to be returned during class. The TA is just going to be entering the marking to the spreadsheet. But he said he'll bring them around for the class. So just a note here, there's some corrections to the PDF course notes. A few students have been emailing me that they spotted the odd error. So if you find something, please let me know and I'll add it to this list of corrections which is on the website. Then regarding the midterm, the take home, I'll post that tomorrow morning on the website at 8:30. I was planning to do it this afternoon, but I just need to check one more data set. But I will have it up by 8:30 tomorrow morning. And then is on Friday, not Thursday, and the engine is now Friday at the office hours in JHE 342 at 1:30. 1:30 is the last time to hand it in on Friday. If you want to hand it in prior to that, you can give it to the secretary in the office and she'll do it. You can email it to me as long as I get it by 1:30 as well. Just take a look at the course website every day while the midterm is going. I may make, in a very unusual case that if there's a mistake in one of the questions, I will make updates to the questions and I'll put that very clearly marked on the website. So just check the website every day during the take home. Then for the written midterm, that's next week Monday. It's during class time, but it's not at this location. I will post on the website the two venues, the class is split in half, so it will be randomly split between two different venues, and it will be about 2.5 hours, probably 2 hours, not 2.5, but it will probably be about 2 hours. You can bring absolutely anything you like with you into the course, into the exam, as long as it's not a cell phone or any other device to communicate with other students. So it's open book. You can bring whichever calculator you like. Probably don't bring laptops, but you can bring whatever calculator you like. And during the class today, I was supposed to talk to you about it. Questions.
Yeah, if you have questions regarding like coding or anything on the take-home midterm, can we still ask you, or is it?
Yeah, so I put some, well, I might as well just skip right to it now. I was going to report by the way at the end of the class today, but just go through it now. Okay. So it will be posted tomorrow morning at 8:30. It's no different to any other exam that you've written. It's only take-home because I need to be able to assess from this course that you can work with real data sets and not the dinky sort of questions that typically asked in exams. So it gives you 3-4 days to work on a real data set and prove to me that you can cover the material in this course to the level required. You can do it in groups. You can do it by yourself. So groups of no more than 3 people. And when you submit your paper, please indicate the people who you've worked with in your group. When I talk about group work the same as last week, just don't share electronic files. So you can discuss it with anyone, you can discuss obviously within your group, but even with other members in the class, but do not discuss or share electronic files outside your group. When you hand in your submission of 3 people, that's to indicate that it's those 3 people, 2 people, a single person that worked on that assignment or on that midterm. The TA and myself, we can answer general questions, but you can't ask specific questions. So the same way in an exam, you can't ask the instructor walking around in the exam very specific questions. You can ask for general guidance, and we can certainly help out with that. I prefer that you email me and not the TA when it comes to the midterm. And then, as I said, you can use any resources to help you, particularly the course notes, but other textbooks you can use other websites, but just don't post the question on a web forum. For example, there's many statistics web forums out there on the web. Don't post the question and ask other people to help you directly later. But if you need help, say how to code a for loop in R, you can look that up or ask people that. And preferably type up your submissions to appendix. Okay, so.
Yeah, did you want us to put our code in the appendix or anything, or just put it in line with our questions?
Yeah, I was going to put some guidance about that on the website, but since it's been raised now, if you do submit our code, it helps me to see where you've gone wrong, if you do go wrong. And I can then give a partial grade at least. If you put nothing, like in some of the assignments, a few people just submit the final answer, then I can't do very much if it's wrong. Also, I really am not too comfortable just giving full grade to a final answer, even if it is right, because there's no discussion of the thought process, and I do allocate some sort of grade to the approach you've taken, for example, describing the assumptions you've made. So please be pretty complete and not just give final answers, and give as much source code as you feel necessary to help me mark your question. You don't have to give anything, of course. You don't even have to give R code. You can use Excel files. But again, those sources, I can't mark an Excel file. Okay. Okay. Good question. For the in-class exam, I will post on the website the T distribution and the normal distribution chart that you will have in the written exam, so you can get a feeling for it and get comfortable with it ahead of the exam. Okay. Is that clear to everyone?
With respect to tables and that kind of stuff, like that scores,
yeah, so that table that you will see in the written test, I will post it on the website ahead of time, so you can get to know what the rows and columns mean in the table. Exactly. So the material in today's class is going to be covered in the written midterm as well as in the table midterm. Obviously not to a great extent. Yeah, for the 600 level, I think that's where the 2.5 hours will cover for the 600 level students. You'll probably have an extra room for the... Oh, I see, sorry, for the groups. Yes, up to two people for the 600 level. It's not three. Okay. Any other questions from last class? I know there were a few people asking questions on the assignment regarding the Schuart chart and the subjects. I just want to make one note here. When it comes to phase one, and you're taking the subgroups in the Schuart chart, say you've got a group of 5 samples, when you use that in phase two is no different to phase one. The only difference is in phase two, you're using data that you've not seen before, not used to calculate your Schuart limits. So you still have to take the same subgroups in phase two as you did in phase one. That was probably the most frequently asked question by email and message for us. Sorry, there was a question back there. Did you want to answer?
No, I just wanted to know the percentage of the formula.
Oh, okay. So the take-home midterm is 15% and the written midterm is 15% of this whole course grade. Okay, so that's all of that out of the way. So let's get started with today's class, which is on linear regression. To me, this is one of the most important classes in the course. It's going to be the basis for design of experiments and analysis of the data from the design. And it's also the basis of latent variable models. So I really hope that today's material is that you'll understand it. And we'll go through it at the pace necessary to make sure that you get all the concepts. But there's two classes on these squares. There's today's class and after the midterm break, when you come back, there'll be another class. So the idea of this material is so that you can quantify the relationship between two variables. So we're moving away from one variable and now going to two variables. And we want to look at the relationship between those two. So here's some examples. You have the yield from a batch system, a lactic acid batch fermentation system. And we want to relate that yield up to the purity of your feedstock going into the reactor. Can you predict the purity So can you use the purity of the sucrose to predict the yield of the lactic acids at the end? And then you could say, well, yes, I can, but there's an error of plus minus 8%. So how do we quantify that 8%? Then your manager might ask you about the relationship between yield and another variable, say glucose purity. And you can say, well, looking back on the historical data, there's no discernible relationship. How do you come up with that conclusion? You can also use these tools from V-squares to understand theoretical models. So the theoretical model for Mel's index shows a nonlinear relationship to viscosity. You can say, well, look, the linear model works pretty well. Even though we know theoretically the model is nonlinear, over the range with which we're operating, the linear model works just as well. So you can maybe show that a nonlinear transformation of the data can still give slightly better results. And we look at nonlinear transformations inside linear least squares in the second class. But for the most part, least squares models actually work very well for most engineering applications because the nonlinearities only come in once you start moving over a very wide range of operation. But for the ranges with which we operate day to day, linear models work pretty well. So the content of today's class is covariance and correlation, and then most of this material will be on the left-hand side. It's pretty small, but it's in the notes as well. We'll look at why we're minimizing errors. We'll look at confidence intervals, so we're going to build on the class from section 2, the covariate confidence intervals. And we'll look at prediction intervals as well. So we'll just say the y predicted is such and such plus minus error. So that's a prediction interval. And we'll also look at this little section of the how to interpret the software how to believe that just some references over there that you can come back to later on. And there's a few more written in there. So let's start off with covariance. So there's correlation and there's covariance. Correlation is something you're probably familiar with. People say these two variables are correlated. They move together. So covariance is a very similar concept. Let's take a look at it with an example. So here I've got an artificial example. We're taking temperature and pressure measurements from a gas cylinder. So we know the ideal gas law, PV equals NRT, applies for moderate conditions. And I've arbitrarily taken that the volume of the cylinder is 20 liters. We're dealing with 1 kilogram of fluorine gas, so that's 14 moles. And then the gas constant. So rearranging PV equals NRT, we can relate the temperature of the gas to the pressure of the gas. And there's this constant beta 1, and it's got to be positive just from the assumptions we've made there. So we're going to look at the covariance now between temperature and pressure. What does it mean, and how do we interpret that? So here's some artificial beta, temperature measured in Kelvin, and the cylinder pressure in kilopascals. And then there's this third variable that I've added in here, which I'll come to in a minute, just the room's humidity. And on that table there, I've computed the mean and the variance of each of the two vectors. The temperature vector and the pressure vector, and we've got their respective means. So the formal definition for covariance is given by two variables, x and y, and it's the expectation operator at curly E, but it's the expectation of x minus x bar times y minus y bar. So x minus x bar just says take x, your vector x, and subtract the mean of every element in the column, and y minus y bar is the same. Multiply those two vectors together, and then what's the expected value of that operation? So if we're looking at changing from x and y, we actually substitute our actual data in here. So temperature and pressure, so t minus t bar and p minus t bar. All that does is you can go, and for each element in this column for temperature, 273, subtract the mean, 327. And you just proceed down the column. So you have a new column, t minus t bar, and the same for pressure, p minus p bar. So that operation is called centering. So you mean center the column. So when you subtract off the mean, we're mean-centric. And if you then compute the mean of t minus t average, so after you subtracted the average and then you go recompute the mean of that new vector, its mean is going to be zero. And the same for pressure. So p minus q bar, and then you recalculate the mean, it's going to have a mean of zero. So this mean-centering operation is very common. You've seen it even when we calculated the z values. So remember when we calculated confidence intervals, one of the steps was to calculate z, and then we said x minus x bar. So in our numerator, we had x minus x bar. That process was centering. We were just shifting our coordinate system from whichever arbitrary units of measurements we were in to zero. So the center of the coordinate system is now at zero after doing that. Okay, so we have a centered vector t and a centered vector p. Multiply those elements together individually, and you get something that looks like that if you use the data. And because these vectors are sorted, I mean, over here we're going from small to large, the median is going to be somewhere here in the middle. It's no surprise then that when we compute the product of t minus t bar and p minus p bar, that the vectors go large and then down to some small number and then grow again. So geometrically, we've shifted our coordinate system to zero and then done the multiplication around zero. We get that result. And you can compute the expected value of that vector. So the expectation operator just says, what is the expected value of that product? Well, for this sample of data we have, we can calculate the expected value is just the mean of those 10 numbers. So sum them up and divide by 10, and that's the expected value. I mean, the true definition of an expectation operator is what is the all possible values that you could get from x minus x bar and y minus y bar. We don't know that, but for this sample of 10 points, we can just calculate what the expectation is for those 10 data. And that's our covariance. If I ask what's the temperature pressure covariance, it's 6,780. And there's also units associated with it. The units are the units of temperature multiplied by the units of pressure. So covariance is very much unit dependent. And as you can see, if you've decided to measure temperature in Fahrenheit, for example, or in a different coordinate system, or you decide to measure pressure in PSI, you get a very different value here every time. So that's why covariance is not something you see often, because it really depends on the frame of reference you've chosen. It's not something that we can intuitively appreciate. Similarly, you can repeat that whole calculation for temperature and humidity. I just put that there for you to try out yourself. So just to continue on then, we've got this fairly unintuitive number, covariance. And it's also a property that if you calculate the covariance of a vector with itself, that comes out just to be the variance. So you've seen this definition in the second class. We said x minus x bar squared, the expectation of that, we define that to be the variance. So covariance is just the variance operation extended to two vectors, x and y. So we're moving out from univariate world of single variances to in this class, two variables, x and y. So the covariance of x and y is the same as the variance of x and x. Now notice also, this is interesting. When you center a vector, x minus x bar, and x minus x bar is the product, the covariance of the centered vector is the same as the covariance of the uncentered vector. So if you shift your coordinate system arbitrarily left and right, it doesn't matter. You'll still always get the same variance. If I give you a vector x and I add 100 to every element in that vector, and I compute the variance before and after, I'm always going to get the same number. So variance and covariance are both insensitive to shifting. And you can see that purely by that minus x bar operation over there. Because if we've shifted our data up by 100 units, we recalculate x bar, it's just going to subtract it right back off again. So if you shift to the left, the moment you take the expectation of that x minus x bar, it's going to shift you back down again. So, insensitive to shifting. And then I just make this comment here. We've often seen in matrix algebra, you see the operation X transpose X, or a vector A transpose B. That is really just a scale form of covariance. If we look at what X transpose X does, is it multiplies every element in X with itself, and then takes the sum of that. That's what X transpose X does. If you look back at this, what's inside the expectation operation, it's the same thing. So imagine X was a vector already centered at 0. X transpose X would just be the part that's inside the expectation matrix. So we'll come back to that in the second part, though, when we start looking at linear algebra ways of expressing these squares. But for now, I'll just point that out to you. And then covariance and correlation, which we'll see next, these describe the overall tendency of the data. And I'll point that out in the next section on correlation. So because covariance is dependent on units, it's not widely used. So we deal with correlation far more frequently. That's why you're probably more familiar with correlation than covariance. Because correlation is covariance, but then we take out the effect of the units. So on our numerator, we have covariance, but then we divide by the variance of X and the variance of Y. So just from a units operations point of view, the numerator's units are the units of X multiplied by the units of Y. The denominator's units are the same thing. So variance is going to be the units X squared times the units of Y squared, and you take the square root of. So you get a dimensionless number. This R value, lowercase r, is called correlation, and it ranges between minus 1 and plus 1. So coming back to the gas cylinder problem, you can calculate for yourself, or you can calculate in R. I've given some R code in the notes how to do it. You can calculate the correlation between temperature and pressure as this very, very, very highly correlated 0.997. It's very close to the upper limits for correlation. Whereas the temperature and humidity are poorly correlated. There's no real relationship. Just from a physical point of view, when we measure the temperature of the gas inside the gas cylinder, we have no expectation that it's going to have any relationship to the room's humidity. So it's no surprise that temperature and humidity, in this example, are not correlated. In other physical systems, sure, you may have a correlation between temperature and humidity, but for this case study, we were measuring the temperature inside the gas cylinder. There's no relationship to humidity outside the gas cylinder. So what does correlation mean? Just so that you get a feeling for some of the numbers, up at the top left over there, I've shown a system which has negative correlation. So as X gets larger and larger along this x-axis, as X gets larger, the Y value decreases. That's a negative relationship. And so the correlation bears out that with the negative sign, and the fact that it's 0.9 negative indicates it's a strong negative correlation. On the other hand, in the bottom left, this is much closer to real engineering systems, where we have positive correlation, but it's of the order of 0.5. So a positive 0.5 correlation shows these two variables. You can see a positive trend in the data, but it's not obvious that it's maybe being corrupted with measurement noise. But this is, when you plot engineering data, the order of magnitude of the correlation you'll see. 0.5, 0.7. If you see higher than 0.7, you've got a really strong correlation. Actually, I think, just correct this, this is not a strong positive correlation. I would just say that's a strong, just a positive correlation. On the other hand, something that's got little correlation or no correlation, this data on the bottom left, I just took two random numbers and I plotted them against each other. There's no correlation. But you will always, you're not going to get an identical mean zero number, or even a very small zero number. You'll get 0.1s, 0.2s. the correlation. No, you don't take the absolute values. In fact, that's how you get the sign. If you took x minus x bar over here, you're going to get a negative number. X minus x bar is 20 minus 10. You're going to get a positive. But then the corresponding y minus y bar is negative. So that's why the correlation comes up. You definitely don't take the absolute value. Now, if you take the absolute value, you're going to lose the negative sign, which is important. And then, just to show one last example, is that correlation doesn't necessarily mean there's no relationship. In this case, we've got a correlation of 0.16. It's very similar to this one of 0.15. But there definitely is a relationship, it's just not a correlation. So just understand that subtlety there. You can get no relationship and a high correlation, and then you can get the converse as well. There's a quadratic relationship between those two things. But when you calculate the correlation is a linear relationship. It comes out at zero. In fact, the correlation, we'll see in the next part of the slides that correlation is very strongly related to the slope between x and y. So there's a negative slope. Here you get a slope of roughly zero, which is why you get a correlation of zero. But there definitely is a relationship. It's just not linear. It's quadratic. Okay, so I'm not a big fan of formulas and proofs and so on. But in the notes, I have given on the page there some formal definitions for covariance and correlation on page 6. I don't really expect you to be able to prove all of them, but I do want you to go through them and at least try to interpret what they mean. They're all building on each other. So for example, the first one is just a definition of what the mean is. And then the second one shows that if you add one variable and another variable, the mean of the sum is the sum of them separately. And then the variance definition, and then if you take a variable x and you multiply it by a constant c, the variance is c squared times the variance as if you had not multiplied it by c. So just go through the rest of those. And the only reason why I include them there is because if you want to prove some of the things that we cover later on in the section, you'll need to have that list available to prove some other things. But it's really not required. It's just there more for completeness. Okay, so non-parametric regression. This is kind of an unusual topic to include in the course because it's not really part of the syllabus at all, but I do feel it's important to at least have a feeling for what non-parametric means and what non-parametric regression means. The reason why I put it in here is also because we'll see some of these graphs later on, and I'd like you to be able to interpret it. So sometimes our relationship between x and y is just too complex to quantify linearly or with some other form of model. So we can resort to a non-parametric model. You can always construct a non-parametric model for any two variables. What it does, though, is it says there's a relationship between x and y, but I'm not going to specify the nature of the relationship. I'm not going to specify what f is. For least squares, we specify what f is and say there's a linear relationship between x and y. But for the non-parametric case, we say we're going to determine that relationship by using the data. We're just going to take the data we have available and infer what f is from that. It means then, if you try to apply that relationship to some other data set, it may not work. But at least, if you're dealing with one particular data set, you'll get a feeling for what f is and what the relationship between x and y are. So here's some data I've taken from the 1971 Canadian Census. It plots the average income at that time, ranging between $0 and $25,000. against the prestige score. So the prestige is how well a person is respected in society or what other people think of various occupations. So physicians are up here and babysitters and so on are down there. The non-parametric model relating the income and prestige is then given by that curved line. The least squares line is the dashed straight line. So if you built the least squares model to try and predict prestige from income, you won't get the slope right. The least squares straight line is going to have a slope that's too shallow. The non-parametric model, on the other hand, is a very good relationship between income and prestige and is accurate over all the data. It is only valid, in fact, for this data set. You could not apply this to the 1971 census of, say, a European country or an Asian country. This is the data for Canada in 1971 at that time. It's specific to this data set. But there may be a reason for you to be able to say, well, let me take the income of a person and predict what their prestige is, or maybe you want to go the other way around. The point is that you would then use the non-parametric curve, the solid black line, to then do that operation. So another terminology for this is the scatter plot smoother. You'll see this a lot of histogram data where they'll kind of plot a smooth-shaped histogram. And then we'll see it used particularly when we examine residuals from the least squares model later on. And if you're really interested in this, you can go read up more about it in that paper. Or in R, you can get that smooth curve using the lowest function. Okay. Now we're going to the meat of today's class, the least squares model. So as I started off by saying, I hope that you really understand the material from today's class because we're only going to build on this more and more, especially in the DOE section. You're going to use these squares to analyze the design experiment data. And in the latent variable section, we'll build all our latent variable models using these squares regression. And today we're only going to look at x and y, and then in the next class we'll look at multiple x's related to one y. But today we're just a single x and a single y. Okay, so how many of you covered least squares in other courses? So what would you say is your level of comfort with least squares? Pretty comfortable with using the model? Yeah? In which software tools have you used to calculate your least squares model? Excel, MATLAB. So in MATLAB, which function? The regress function, I guess. Or you just get it from the plot. If you right click on the plot afterwards, you can superimpose the regression line, I guess. So today's class, we're not just going to look at how to get B0 and B1, the parameters from the limited model. We're going to look at how you interpret it. So you may have used these models in the past as a way, for example, in physics labs, I remember in undergraduate, we had to plot a various quantity x and a quantity y, and then the slope of that line was, say, the gravitational constant g. So you can, or in reactor design course, you can plot temperature versus concentration for a proposed system, and the slope will turn out to be the reaction rate coefficient. So you probably used it in those contexts in the past, but in today's class, we're going to focus on how to interpret b beta 0 and beta 1. We're going to construct confidence intervals for beta 0 and beta 1. And hopefully there's some time at the end where we'll be able to show how to derive a confidence interval for y predicted. Okay, so just some terminology. We'll call beta 0 and beta 1, these are the population parameters. So we're saying our model, whether we're right or wrong, we're saying the population model is that beta 0 plus beta 1 times x is going to give our expected value of y. So taking the expectation operator away, we then add that error on at the end, small e. And so we've got beta 0, beta 1, and this e term, which are our population parameters. Now, notice that the e term is the error of y. It's not the error of x. X is assumed to be measured perfectly. There's absolutely no accounting for any error in X. And you know that in engineering systems, certainly when we measure our X, we have an error in that X. But for this derivation over here, we're assuming our X is measured perfectly. So the error at the end there actually belongs to Y. That E term is unmodeled components of the linear system. Maybe the true model is beta 0 plus beta 1x plus beta 2x squared. But we've dropped out the beta 2x squared, and so that gets sucked into that E term at the end. So by making the mistake of assuming the wrong structure of the model, our errors are going to get larger. So that gets sucked into there. We also have measurement error on the Y going into E, and maybe other random errors that from the system. But the point I want to make is that X is measured without error, and the Y's are measured with error. When we come to the latent variable models in the last 3 weeks of this course, we'll actually consider error in X. But for now, we're assuming X is measured error-free. You can use any method you like to estimate beta 0, beta 1, and the error. So you can use absolutely any method, and I'll mention 4 alternatives after this slide. But the point is that after you've measured them, we'll call those B0 and B1 now. So those will become our estimates, whereas the betas are our population parameters, which are unknown. But our estimates then are B0, B1, and B. And then we write that B0 times B1 times X plus this error E gives us back our Y. And y hat is b0 plus b1 times x. What do I mean by that terminology? Just look on this figure here. Here's our point, x, I, and y, I. And the solid line is the regression line, the least squares line, with slope of b1 and intercept of b0 over there. So we fitted that line from the data. Bringing in a new point now, over here, say, you've got that point with coordinates xi and coordinates yi. The prediction value, y hat, is this point on the least squares line, where the pointer is. That would be your y hat value. So given that xi, that point over there is your y hat. And then the residual distance from y hat to y is your area. So just to put that as a picture, how can you make those E smaller? That's what we're asking. So given n pairs of data, n pairs of x, I, and y, so all these blue points, you've just given coordinates of x and y, how do you calculate B0 and B1? Well, one way is to minimize the errors. So make all those EI values small in some way. But there's several ways. The first one is obviously least square, so you take the sum of the square of those errors. So each EI is squared, and then you add all those EIs together. That's the first option over there. Why not take it to the power of 4? You could, there's no reason why we can't. I mean, EI squared just says we want to penalize things quadratically. So a large deviation is still penalized more than a small deviation due to the squaring effect. But you may want to really penalize outliers, and then you use EI to the power of 4, because you could easily do that. Or you could do the sum of the perpendicular distances. By that I mean, just going back to this geometric point, you could take the distance from that point perpendicular to the line. So we're dropping the line down vertically onto the slope, but why not find that line so that you minimize the sum of perpendicular distances? That's an equally valid option. Another option is to minimize the sum of absolute deviations. So rather than squaring them, you just take the absolute value and sum the absolute values up. And then the last option I mentioned here is calculate all the errors and just compute the median. And your objective function becomes to minimize the median of all these EIs. So you collect a whole lot of EI values. So for the way we could do this in principle is to assume a value of B0 and B1, compute the EIs, and then compute the median of those EIs, and then your objective function is to iterate around to compute, to change B0 and B1 so you get the least median of squares. And that's a robust form of regression, which we won't cover in this class. But why do we use least squares? Well, there's a number of reasons that I mentioned in the notes. Mainly is computationally easy. You get very low variances of the data, of the means, and that is really the reason why we use it. More than any other reason is the ability to is to get low variances between zeros and one. By that I mean is once you've computed the model, you're going to use the model in the future, so B0 plus B1 times XI. If you're able to have Bs that have got low variance, it means that your error when you've estimated those Bs are is the smallest possible. And actually, least squares gives, under very specific assumptions, which we'll cover later on, we get the best estimates between 0 and B1. And then a few other reasons are that it's faster than computers and and it's easy to prove a lot of mathematical proofs on it. But there's some other issues with those other methods then, particularly they lead to unstable solutions or multiple solutions. So it's not always the most efficient. So least squares is generally the way to go. Okay, so from your optimization course, you can minimize an objective function. So most of you have taken the 4G class with Ben Warsh, that's right. Are you not? You're taking it now. So you've covered unconstrained optimization. No, not yet? In the class today. Well, okay, so then this will work out well. So write your objective function as f. F is a function of B0 and B1, your parameters that you're changing. And there's your sum of squares. So if I write out EI a little bit more thoroughly, it's YI with Y minus Y hat. So Y minus Y hat over here. So you'll get a long string of these numbers. For every data point that you have, you'll have a Y minus Y hat squared plus another term, plus another term. So this summation actually expands out into a very long term on the board. It gets right up to every data point that you have any. Okay? But you know from, yeah.
Why don't you subtract B1, X1?
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah, please make that correction. Yeah, so minus B0 minus B1 XI. So the intention is that YI minus YI. This is BI. Now, the easiest way to do it if you haven't taken a course like 4G is you just write down guesses for B0 and B1. So you assume B0 is going to be some number and B1 is going to be some number and calculate the value f of B0 and B1. And you do that on a grid, on a table of numbers, and you find which value of f gives you the lowest. That's a brute force approach. So let's take that approach. So for this gas cylinder example that we started off with. There we said we're going to relate the pressure P up to the temperature in the cylinder using that term V0 and beta 0 and beta 1. But we know from the gas law, so we've got PV equals nRT, and we've said that P equals beta 1 T, where beta 1 is equal to nR over V. Okay? We know that beta 0 is 0. As you take temperature down to 0 Kelvin, you're going to have no pressure. So we can just exclude that from our search. Now we're down to finding only beta 1.
So now our model is really one of P equals beta of T. Or if we write our objective function F, we just say F is a function of beta 1, which is then the sum of all the EI squares. So if you only have one search variable now, beta 1, you don't have to search across two variables. Okay, so we can then, well, where do we start with beta 1? Well, we've got good tests here. We know the number of moles in our system, the gas constant, the volume. A good starting point is 5.8. So you can write equally spaced points between 5 and 6.5, say. Write down V1 is, say, 5. Plug it into your equation, and then calculate all the PIs, and then calculate the sum of squares. And then construct a graph where you're plotting this value of V1 versus F. And since our objective is to minimize F by changing V1, that's what the least squares is asking us to do, is to find the minimum sum of squares of the errors. As we plot this, you should find your minimum at some point, and that would be your V1 value that you choose for that particular data set. Okay, so over here in your notes as well, the bottom of page 9 there is the plot for this particular system. Now, it's a little bit misleading in that it seems that the minimum is at 0 on the objective function. That is not, it's not really the case. It's just the scale of the y-axis make it seem so. But really, the minimum does not necessarily occur at 0. But it will always be some positive number. And so you can read off, yes, in this case, the minimum does happen to be pretty close to our initial 5. Okay, but this brute force approach just doesn't work, and it doesn't work well at all for large data sets. So let's go to an analytical approach. Okay, I think for that is a pretty picture there. If you were in two variables, V0 and V1, then you would have a quadratic function in two variables, which is a bowl shape from your secondary math. I guess you can call that, you'll have this bowl function. What we've done over here, when we considered just V1, is we basically fixed V0 at some point, and we've taken a slice through that bowl and just looked at the cross-section. But if you are minimizing two variables, you will have a bowl-shaped function. Now what's really nice about an unconstrained quadratic objective function, and you'll probably come to this with Benoit if you haven't already, is that it's called a convex function, and it's guaranteed to have a unique minimum. That, just those two reasons alone are probably why these squares regression is used so often. You're guaranteed for any data set of x and y points that you will find a unique minimum, firstly. The last thing you want is to put your data in and then run this system two or three times in your computer and get different answers each time. So with least squares, you're guaranteed a unique minimum. And we're also guaranteed we'll always find the minimum. There will always be one. And that's because the objective function is a convex function. So that's true of any unconstrained optimization problem. That as long as it's convex, you'll always find the minimum, and the minimum is unique. Okay, so analytically, you can solve it this way. Back to F, B of 0 and B of 1. Again, the same mistake that I've been making the whole time, that yi minus b0 minus b1 xi. But whether you've taken Benoit's optimization course or not, you'll know from at least from your math course, that to compute the stationary points of a function f as a function of b0s and b1s, we calculate the partial derivatives of f with respect to those parameters and set them equal to 0. That gets you your stationary point, which is either a minimum or a maximum, but at least it's a stationary point. You compute then your second derivatives with respect to f to confirm that the optimum is a minimum. In this case, you can show that as well. We'll look in the next slide that the partial derivatives, the second partial derivatives, are actually positive, so that is indeed a global minimum. Okay, so there's the partial derivatives. and I suggest you do this by hand in some time after the classes, just to help you understand what is going on. So F, we're taking out F again. This time I have the sign of y. And you take the partial with respect to B0, and you set that equal to 0. And you do the same of F, take the partial with respect to B1, set that equal to 0. Now you have two equations and two unknowns. You have two very long equations in two unknowns. Take a look at the first equation. That's the summation of I equals 1 to n. So if you have 50 data points, there's going to be 50 of these terms all summed together. So minus 2 times that, plus, and then another minus 2 times that, all added, and set that all equal to 0. The only unknowns are B0 and B1, and you have two of these long equations, these two unknowns. You can set those equal to 0 and solve. The easiest way is to actually solve the first one. You take the summation, and you can calculate that B0 is equal to y bar, the average of all your y data, minus B1 times x bar. So that's a little bit weird, because you're saying your B0 is a function of B1. Okay? Well, it's not too bad. When you do the second equation, you set that equal to 0 and you solve. You'll get something similar, but then you'll just substitute in and then resolve for B1 and get a term that's not a function of B0. Take a look at the numerator of that B1 term. Yeah, it's your covariance of x. Well, it's proportional to the covariance, because covariance was the expectation of. This is the summation of, but it's within a scaling factor n, it's your covariance of x and y. So recall then earlier when we were speaking about correlation, I said that it's the slope between your x and your y. This is where that comes from. You've got a scaled version of your covariance. And the denominator is similar to your variance. It's x minus x bar squared. So the denominator is related to the variance of x. So that's why we looked at correlation and covariance at the start of this class, because the interpretation there is that the slope coefficient, B1, is strongly related to the correlation between x and y. So strongly correlated data, you're going to have a strong slope. With data with no correlation between x and y, this B1 is going to be equal to 0, or some number close to it, within the scaling factor. To okay. Some other things you can prove to yourself are, firstly, that the sum of the errors add up to 0. Okay, this doesn't really have any practical significance right now, but you can easily see that the sum of the errors add up to 0. You get that from this line over here. So this is actually the error. Y minus B0 minus B1 xi. That is the residual, EI. That term in the summation is EI. So minus 2 times the sum of EI equals 0. Well, then EI, the sum of EI is 0. That's where that comes from. Secondly, from this line over here, that B0 is y bar minus B1 x bar, you can prove that the regression line passes through y bar and x bar. So even if y bar and x bar, they don't have to be a data point that you've collected. You've collected 10 data points, say. X bar and y bar don't have to be one of your data points. They just are the mean of it. But still, the regression line will pass through x bar, y bar without error. So that's a useful way to check your regression afterwards. Sort of like your pivot point, and I'll show that. Another thing you can prove from those same equations is that xi times ei, or in other words, x transpose e is equal to 0. Now, recall from, again, your second year math class, when the dot product, in this case, x transpose e, the dot product, and the dot product of two vectors is equal to 0, what does that mean? The dot product of two vectors,
I think they're perpendicular.
Perpendicular, exactly. So we're saying that x's are perpendicular to e. And what that says is our data is perpendicular to our errors. Our errors have no effect on the x data we've used. You can also show that, let me just step back here. The residuals are uncorrelated with the input variables x. So if we step back to correlation, as I put here that what does x transpose x mean? Well, it's the covariance, or equivalently the correlation. It's the same thing, just a scaled form of covariance. So x transpose e, or equal to 0, means that there's no relationship between those two vectors, x and e. There's no information in the residuals that's in x. Similarly, we can show that y hat times e, or y hat transpose e, is equal to 0. So that shows that the predictions you make are uncorrelated to your errors as well. And then finally, as we mentioned earlier, that b0 depends on b1. So you can't estimate these parameters individually. You have to estimate b0 and b1 together. They go together. So the error in b1 affects the error in b0 and vice versa. Okay, so just some questions here and then we'll take a break. Given this definition of b0 and b1, what would be the units of b1? Well, they're the units of y divided by x. Do you see how that comes? So we've got x on the numerator and y on the numerator, and then we've got x twice on the denominator. So the units of b1 are y divided by x. And that also makes sense if you write out the regression equation. If you say these are in the future, y hat is b0 plus b1 times x, you're saying the units of b1 are the units of y divided by the units of x, multiplied by the units of x. So that cancels out to be the units of y. Similarly, the units of b0 needs to be in the same units of y, so that you get your prediction to be more consistent. So when we're looking at the gas cylinder example, and beta 1 had units of, or B1 had units of, what would that be, between kilopascals divided by Kelvin. So we had B1 was about 5.8 kPa over Kelvin. What does it mean, that number of 5.8?
It just means your pressure will increase by 5.8 kilopascals to 1 degree.
Yeah, so the interpretation is exactly right. So on average, the increase of 1 Kelvin will lead to an average increase of 5.8 kPa in the gas cylinder. So it's important to say on average that a delta 1 increase of the denominator's units leads to that change of B1 in the Y variable. And similarly for B0, it's the intercept. It's when you take your X variable down to 0, that's the expected value of Y. And in many regression cases, that B0 number is just meaningless. Because your data are so far away from 0, your intercept can be any number with such large error. So we don't typically pay a lot of attention to B0, unless we are operating close to 0. Now, this is an interesting one. How would the denominator term for B1 equal 0? And what would that mean?
The mean equals all the values of x, so there's like one number.
Yeah, so if you had to plot your data, what would it look like?
Straight line.
Which way? Which is like horizontal, vertical, diagonal, straight line?
A vertical.
Yeah. So you get, in the very unusual case, all your data are the same, so if you're plotting your x over here and the y, it says that you've got all your x's stacked up like that. at different values of y. You've got a perfectly vertical line. That's the only case that you get a denominator of zero. So it's no surprise that v1 is going to be infinitely slow. It just means that you're going to get a crazy answer if there's no variation in your data set. So that doesn't happen very often for real cases, but if you're in a computer system and you're doing automated regressions, you often get your regression system crashing when you put in this nonsensical case where there's no variability in your x data. Or conversely, as long as there is variation in your x data, you will always obtain a solution. That's the only time you get a degenerate solution. In fact, when I said earlier that you're always guaranteed an optimum for these squares, I'm not 100% correct. This is the only case in which you won't get an optimum. All other realistic cases, you'll get a global optimum for that optimization problem. Just wondering whether to do this. We'll just cover this example during a break, because then this is a new section after this. So we'll take 15 minutes for you to stretch your legs and grab something to drink and whatnot. But you can come back then and look at this case study. This is a simple example. I think there's 11 data points here. There's no units or anything. It doesn't correspond to a real system. But it's just for you to get used to the mechanics of deriving the same in a test or and how to use the model. But here what we want to look at is an estimate of V0 and V1. From the given data. So calculate what V0 and V1 are. And then also write down your prediction of y hat when xi mu is 5.5. To make it easier for you, and I would never ask you an exam, I would never just give you raw data and just ask you to do it. That's just a waste of everyone's time. I'd always just compute a few of these numbers over here, of x minus x bar, so on, for summation terms. So let's resume at, say, 10 to 4. And so for the equation for V0 and V1 is given by derivation here. So obviously you have to calculate V1 first before you get to V0. Answers for V1. Anyone calculate V1
first?
0.5. So it's 55 divided by 110. So the numerator term is given for you over there. 55 divided by 110 gives you V1. If you want to calculate V1, then you can move on to calculating V0 from the relationship over here. Y bar minus V1 X bar. So it would be 7.5 minus 0.5 times 9. So there we have 3. You get a 3 for V0 and okay, so y hat for xi for 5.5 is, anyone got the answer there? So just as everyone's come back now, there's course evaluations that I've handed out. Does everyone have one? There's two sides to the page. I'm just handing them out a little earlier than normal. These are not the official ones. These are just for me but it just helped me adjust for the rest of the classes in the semester, because the usual course evaluations come through that didn't do anything about. So just hand them in sometime later in the class. So ready to move on to the next level. So 0.5 times 5.5. And this is, so is this 5.5 divided by 2 is? Yeah. Okay, so the next section is to go away from the basics, like the mechanics of calculating the model is really straightforward. You can put the data in to the software in your X column and your Y column, and then on page 12 of the notes I've shown you how to calculate the model in the software. So just a quick word on that. In R, once you have your data in your vector, so you've got a vector X and you have a vector Y, they need to be of the same length. In R, the way you calculate the linear model is you say Ln is the name of the function, the linear model. It's not called least squares or anything like that, because the linear model function Ln does much, much more than just least squares. We won't cover even half the use of Ln in this course. But Ln, and then open brackets, and then you say the name of what you want to model symbolically. You say Y tilde, the key on the top right and top left of the keyboard, X. That says Y as described by X. So interpret this tilde as the phrase as described by. So give me a linear model where Y is described by X. And that will return for you an object. So you can say model equals Ln and then brackets that. So then once you have model, you can deal with model in several ways. And I've shown here, if you don't give Ln, if you don't assign the output from Ln to anything, it just gives you the intercept and slope. That's good enough for this part of the course. Later on, we'll assign it to a variable model and then deal with model, but I'm not going to show you. So just use the as described by to build your linear model. You don't need to write the equations like these summation terms and so on in R. There's no point in developing all of that yourself the way you could. But you can just use the Ln function in R. Okay, the next step is once you have this model, you have your B0 and your B1, how well does the model work? That's what this whole next section of the class is about. You could ask which part of the data is error, which part of the data is systematic. So what is your noise, what is your signal in the data set? Recall when you plot this up, that's your data. Your regression line is going to go through that, so there's obviously some sort of systematic component in the data, and there's some residual error component in the data. That's what we're going to look at in this section. You'll also want confidence intervals of the slope. For example, it will be helpful to know that the confidence interval for beta 0 is perhaps minus 2.3 to 3.2. That tells you, look, it's probably not significant. If beta 0 equal to 0 meant something to you, the fact that this spans the range of 0, it just kind of gives you a feeling for the extent to which that intercept term can move in. Similarly, you can get a confidence interval for the slope. So maybe it's a rate constant, for example. The slope symbolizes a rate constant in units of 1/seconds. Then knowing that beta 0 covers that range will be meaningful. For example, if you're designing some sort of reactor, the lower bound will give you one size of your reactor that you need to have, and then the upper bound will give you another different size. So it gives you a feeling for the sensitivity. And in particular, we'll look at the question, how can you make that range smaller? That's obviously more of more importance in once you have the confidence interval, okay, so what? How can I make it smaller or bigger? Probably never bigger because you want a higher accuracy in your confidence interval. So how can you make it smaller? We'll look at that. And something else you might want from the model is to know the prediction error for new x coming in. So like in this example where we brought x in of 5.5. So if we looked at it, now regression line went along this way, 5.5 comes in over here. We're getting a value out over here on the y-axis. But there's some sort of error range associated with that prediction of y hat. What is that range? The 95% confidence interval for that. Okay, but in order to get all these advantages, we need to make quite a few assumptions. And some of them are going to be pretty strong assumptions about the data. But notice up to this point, we've not spoken of any assumptions. You can take any x vector, doesn't have to be normally distributed, it does not have to have any sort of properties. You can just take your x vector and your y vector, calculate d0, d1, and you can get predictions. It's only when you want to start working with those predictions, for example, knowing what the confidence interval is, or the d0 and d1 and the prediction interval. It's only once you start needing to make these extra, or starting to get this extra information from the model that you need to make these assumptions. So what are these assumptions? And then we'll talk about that. Okay, so let's start first by breaking down the variability. In the second class of this course, I drew this silly line on the board, and I said we want our lines to be straight. We want our plants to operate with beautiful flat lines, because then we don't have to do anything on that. We can just sit in our office and play tennis or something. But it's never like that. In industry, you're always going to have this variation. But this is what we're striving for, is that flat line. And you'll see in regression, that's our baseline as well. We're going to judge everything relative to some arbitrary flat line. Not necessarily zero. It doesn't have to be zero on the y-axis. We're going to judge everything relative to some mean point. And that's what we're going to do here in analysis of variance. So doing nothing or having no model, the best estimate of y that you can have, if you have data and you don't have the time to build any model on it, the best estimate of y hat you can come up with without a model is to say y hat is equal to y bar. Okay? What does that mean? If you plot your data out, so here's y and x. So there may be some sort of relationship there, but you just don't have the ability to compute it. The best estimate for any y hat is to just say y bar, the average of my y's. That's your baseline. So this horizontal flat line that I drew up there, that's your baseline against which we're going to compare everything else. This is the worst you can do. Right? If you're not going to do anything else, this is the worst possible way that you could say, same thing, that everything is relative to that point. You can only do better than that. So if you do nothing, you say y hat is equal to y bar. Now your model is that y hat is equal to b0 plus b1 xi. That's what you can predict from your model. And then the third part of your variability is to show everything else that's left over in the errors. Now these three must add up to the total variance. So remember that variance is defined as, the definition of variance is deviation from the mean. So we took the sum of squares, x minus x hat, x bar, take the sum of those squares, and we divide through by n or n minus 1. So by definition, variance is always some sort of deviation from a mean point. Now, in this case, the first case, y hat equals y bar, if you said y hat equals y bar, all these terms are going to add it to zero because there is no variability in that system. The system with a flat line has no variance. So we don't really have to consider that case. But then the second one, the variance for component one, So that should be variance for component 0.00 by definition. Yeah, that refers to this over here. And then the total variance of y is going to then be the model variance of component 2, and then the error variance. So if that's a little bit vague, let's look at it geometrically. Let's start off with the geometric before we go algebraic. So here's a generic system with one data point, xi, yi, and our regression line. So we're at the stage now where we've computed the regression line and we're trying to analyze the variability in the system. This distance from that point down to the regression line is called the RSS, or the residual sum of squares, and I'll cover that what that means in a minute. Then the distance from the line to y bar is the regression sum of squares, and then this is the total sum of squares. So I'm just setting the scene over there, but let's come back to the to some algebra. You can show for any point xi, so coming back to this, you can fix your point xi, and whether yi is above the regression line or somewhere below the regression line, it doesn't matter. But for that, any point above or below, you can calculate this relationship, that y minus y bar is equal to y hat minus y bar plus yi minus y hat. So what does all that mean? It just says that if you take this distance, RSS, the distance from the actual x point, from the actual y, sorry, to the regression line, that's y hat, that's the residual sum of squares, plus the regression sum of squares, it has to add up to the total sum of squares. So geometrically, you can write this, write that down. That's the first one. Then you square every term, and when you square the right-hand side, you actually have to expand it out into all of that. And some of those terms fall away. I'm not going to go through the mechanics, but for example, you'll get a term there called y hat times the error. We've shown, for example, that y hat times e transpose is equal to 0. So a few of those terms in this line will fall away. Not too interested in how in deriving it, you can go through it if you're interested. But what it comes down to is, after simplifying, is this nice line over here, which shows that the total sum of squares, so that's y minus your baseline y bar, so take every data point y, subtract it from the baseline y bar. So recall what y bar is just this line over here, through which, remember, the regression line passes right through the center of x bar y bar. So just take every data point in your model, y, subtract it from y bar and square them. That's our total sum of squares. That's going to add up to the regression sum of squares and the residual sum of squares. What do we mean by the regression sum of squares? That's the sum of squares in going from y bar, the average, to the prediction. So this is the sum of squares we go from our baseline y bar up to the prediction y hat. So for every data point coming in, we get a y hat. That's our regression prediction. That difference from y hat to the baseline is the regression sum of squares. Then we've got something left over, because we're not going to have perfect predictions. The distance from y, the actual y, to y hat. So geometrically, the distance from this data point y to the line is the residual sum of squares, the residual after prediction. That's going to, the sum of those is the residual sum of squares. And we've shown here that they add up. So the part that you can explain, this is the part you can explain, this is the systematic part of your model, this is the error part of your model. So you're breaking down all your sum of squares into these two components, an explained and unexplained part.
On the variance, why don't you take the deviation from the regression line instead of the deviation from the mean? Wouldn't that?
So y minus y. Which one?
The equation on the bottom right. No, on the board.
Oh.
Can you take the deviation from the regression line, like after you plug the regression line, can you take deviation of every S in that line instead of from the mean. So it's a residual.
You can. With this, what you'll get is you still get something like this. This first line is a geometric statement that the sum of these portions must add up to a total. So it just depends on what your frame of reference is. If you choose, I've chosen here my frame of reference is the baseline y-bar. But if you chose the regression line, then the terms will just rearrange in that equation. But still, when you take the squares, you can still get down to this form over here. You'll always add up with this statement that your total variance in the system is equal to the part you can explain by regression, and then the part you just can't explain, the part left over after the regression. But you can try and derive it like that, and you'll still get it. It's just a rearrangement of the same statement. Okay, it seems a little bit abstract. Why are we doing this breakdown like that? But I hope to make it a bit clearer when we look at it in this table. And then we'll derive some values from this table, and we'll see where this is all going. So you may have seen this in a pure stats course. They love these tables. They call them analysis of variance tables. I'm just showing this here to you so you kind of get familiar with it, because you see it in some of the software packages. We're not going to focus too much on ANOVA at all in this course. But I do want you to just understand that an ANOVA table is nothing more than a statement of where your variability is coming from. So we can say we've got variance of two types. The variance due to the regression, the part of our model we can predict, in going from y bar over here, the mean, up to our prediction. So going from our baseline to our prediction y hat, that's our regression part. Then there's the residual part, in going from y onto, going from y hat up over to the raw data, to y itself. Okay, so let's take a look at that again. We're going from our baseline y bar up to our prediction y hat. That's the regression portion. Then we go from y hat further to the actual raw data measurement, y. That's our error. That distance, the sum of this distance plus the sum of that distance, is the total distance in going from y itself to the baseline. Okay? Just from geometry, you can do that. The degrees of freedom associated with regression are 2 degrees of freedom. Okay, where does that come from? There's 2 degrees of freedom in the sense that we've got n data points. So our total number of data points n is n to begin with. We use 2 of those degrees of freedom to estimate the b0 and b1. Why is it called that? Because if I just had only 2 data points, so just conceptually, if I had the degenerate case of 2 data points, one over here and one over here, you can fit a regression line through those 2 points without error and calculate B0 and B1. But you've got no further degrees of freedom to adjust that line. That line is absolutely fixed. There's 0 degrees of freedom after fitting the B0 and B1 parameters. Those 2 points. If I add the 3rd point over here, you've got some leeway now to adjust this line to best fit these 3 data points. And you get a different solution, slightly different solution, but you've got 1 degree of freedom left after that. Because you use 2 of them up to calculate B0 and B1. Coming to this system with 3 data points, you wouldn't do this in practice, but you could conceptually see where you know what B0 is, you know what B1 is, and you know what one of your data points are, and from that you can back calculate what the other 2 data points were. I mean, it's pointless exercise in principle, but it explains what a degree of freedom is. Degree of freedom is how many chances you have to move that line around. And you have n to start off with from your data points, minus the 2 that you use to fit the model. So that's what the degrees of freedom means up again. So 2 degrees of freedom are associated with the regression step because we're estimating 2 parameters. In the next class, we'll estimate 3 or 4 or 5 parameters because we'll have three or four or five x variables that we're going to relate it to y. But in this case, we're only relating one x to y. So there's that x, the slope for that x, plus the intercept. That's why we use those two equations. And then the balance of them are associated with the error. You can calculate the sum of squares due to regression. That's just y hat minus y. So calculate the square of that and sum that over every data point in your data set, and that's the regression sum of squares. And then the residual sum of squares, RSS, is just yi minus y hat. And you sum that n times, so I equals 1 to n. That summation is equal to RSS, the residual sum of squares. And the total sum of squares then is yi minus y bar summed over every data point. So that's all that an ANOVA table is doing. It's just showing you where your variance is coming from. Either it comes from regression or it comes from error. And then it calculates these sums of squares. And then you'll sometimes see the mean square reported, and that just divides through the sum of squares by the degrees of freedom. Okay? Now, this term here, RSS, we sometimes divide it through by n minus k. So if I divide this by n minus k, that says it's the standard error. Now I want to just spend a few minutes explaining what the standard error is. So we'll call this SE. So S lowercase e, or S sub e rather. The residual sum of squares divided by n minus k. Now, what is this term over here? If I rewrite this term in the numerator a little bit differently. So that's y minus y hat. That's nothing more than the error. So y minus y hat is ei. Okay? And it's the sum of squares of those. So ei squared, so the sum of those divided by n minus k. So if my residual sum of squares, ei, residual sum of squares, divided by n minus k to account for the degrees of freedom. Geometrically, that is nothing more than my average error. If I take my e's and I sum them, square them, and I divide it through by my number of data points, particularly if I take the square root of all of this, that becomes like my standard deviation. It's your average error, the standard error. So it's, if ei was really small, it gives you a feeling for what your prediction error is going to be like. Because your prediction error, or your predictions rather, are given by so y at is equal to e0 plus e1x. So that's our prediction of y. And our prediction error is y minus y hat. That is the ER. So when we take the sum of these squares and we take the square root of this, this is going to give us a feeling for the average error in our model. Now I give an example. Say I'm predicting the batch yield in kilograms. And you can use an X variable, say for example, the raw material purity. But you're interested in this prediction error, the standard error of 3.4 kilograms. So you calculate this term here is equal to 3.4 kilograms. Because it's in the same units of y. What does that mean? So we've said our standard error is ei. So this is kind of like an average ei. And y is equal to y hat plus an error e. So this e term gives us a feeling for what the error is in our prediction. In particular, if you assume the errors were normally distributed, this is the standard deviation, and we know that from a normal distribution, standard deviation would cover 1 sigma. Minus 1 sigma up to 1 plus 1 sigma. So from a normal distribution, about 2/3 of your predictions would be within error of plus or minus 3.4 kilograms. Or it would, again, with the normal distribution, you know that about 95% of the predictions lie within plus or minus 2 sigma. So you can, I guess all I want you to understand here is that the standard error is like the standard deviation of the residuals. And it's a quantity, one of the very first quantities we look at when we want to understand how a model is performing. So contrary to what you might have done in the past and looked at R squared as the very first number to try and figure out is this model good or bad, a better way to understand how your model is working is to look at the standard error. It should be the first number you look at to see how your model is working, not R squared. Because it's giving you an indication of, for this given data set, I'm getting predictions, say, plus or minus 3, 4 kilograms, or 2 times the standard error, 95% of your predictions will lie within plus or minus 2 times. Is that clear? So one standard error covers about 2/3 of your predictions, and 2 standard errors, up or down, covers 95% of your predictions. So it's, from an engineering judgment point of view, it's a good way to see how your model is performing. Okay, so in this next exercise, I'd like to take you to take a few minutes and do the following. Consider a case, this is just a hypothetical case, where y, all your y's are just equal to errors. There's no v0 and there's no v1 here. So it's a model where v0 and v1 are 0, so yi is equal to vi. So just as a hypothetical case. And consider the second case where yi is equal to the standard linear model for any value of p0 and p1, but assume that whatever the values of p0 and p1 are, that they're able to predict those y's perfectly. In other words, your ei's are 0 in the second case. So in the first case, you only have error, and in the second case, your yi is equal to p0 plus p1 xi plus 0. Ei's are 0. There's no error. So I'd like you to follow these 4 steps. Even if you only do the first 3-4 of them, that's great. Those are the 3 I really want to focus on in today's class. Just draw a generic plot for case 1 and case 2 for what that would look like. And write down an ANOVA table. Do make up one of these tables like that. Just put any fake numbers in it. But obviously, that would have to be correspond to the case that you're dealing with. And then thirdly, generate that ratio of the regression sum squared divided by the total sum squared. So just take a few minutes with your neighbor and create those 2 tables. People are a little bit confused with what's going on here. So I think the main reason why I wanted to include this here is these 2 cases represent 2 extremes. In the very first case, there's no systematic variation in your process. There's no model to be built. In the second case, it's equally unrealistic. It's a perfect system where you're able to predict everything perfectly from these around. So they represent the 2 extremes. All your real regressions will lie somewhere in between. But you need to understand the 2 extremes in order to understand the values you're going to get in the ANOVA table. Okay, so in the first case where you've got yi equal ei, coming back to the ANOVA table, you need to enter a value in. You need to enter in values for the second column. So for the regression, you've got y hat minus y bar. And for a system like the wide, largest areas, so we've got a system where our yi is just error, vi. So for a system like that, our y hat is going to be 0. Right? Y hat is equal to v0 plus v1x1, or vi, v1xi. But because those two terms are 0, our best prediction we can make of y is 0. Okay? So we know what y hat is over there. Y bar is also 0. Because the y's are just errors, and the errors are always centered around 0. So the best estimate of y bar we can make is 0. Okay? Because our yi's are equal to errors, and the expected value of the errors is 0. So errors are normally distributed around 0, or we derived that earlier on over there, the very first line, the sum of the yi's are always 0. So the mean y bar has to be 0 as well. Okay? So the first entry in that ANOVA table for fictitious case 1 is 0 minus 0. There's no regression. In a model where there's just errors, there's nothing to regress. The second row is yi, or in other words, ei, minus y hat. So the second row is just ei's. Ei minus 0. And then the total is also just ei, because yi is 0, yi is e's, and y bar is 0. Okay? So your first column is 0, ei, ei, for that fictitious case. Now your degrees of freedom for the regression is 0, because there's no parameters to estimate. So your error degrees of freedom are n, and your total degrees of freedom are n. So 0 and n for that case. So your regression sum of squares is equal to 0. Your residual sum of squares is equal to the sum of squares of these EI values. So it doesn't matter what it is, but let's just put it in symbolically. It's just whatever that comes out to be. And your total sum of squares is equal to RSS. And if you calculate the ratio, I ask for the ratio RSS divided by TSS, so the residual sum of divided by the total sum of squares. Regression sum of squares. Okay. So that's for your first case where there's no systematic variation in the process. Okay? Everyone clear on the first case? Yeah. The degrees of freedom are 0, because B0 is 0 and B1 is 1. There's nothing to estimate. Or even, it doesn't really matter in this case. Even if you did estimate them, they just happen to be 2 and n minus 2. Okay, so the second case we looked at was perfect relations. So can I erase this over here? In the case with perfect relations, yi is equal to v0 plus v1 with v1 xi. So we don't even need to write the ei because they are 0. For perfect predictions, we have no residuals. Okay. So that's what yi is. Y bar is whatever y bar is, the sum of the mean and the y's. And y hat I is just equal to b0 plus b1xi. So for the case of perfect predictions, your y hat term is just equal to your raw data in a very unrealistic case. So when you calculate that first line, the regression sum of squares, y hat minus y bar, it's just going to be y hat minus y bar, it's just going to be this term. Minus y bar, and the sum of squares of that. So you could put in a number there for that, but symbolically it would just be that. The second row, the error, is y minus y hat. That's the difference between these two. It's going to be 0. For the error row, there's 0 errors. And then your total is just this term repeated again. So I'm just going to write here. Well, you can just repeat that first line. Okay, but the key point is when you've got no prediction errors, your second row is just a row of zeros. Your y minus y hat is 0. So there's no residual distance. So your RSS, so just jumping ahead, your RSS will be equal to 0. And your regression sum of squares will be the sum of squares of that, whatever that comes out to. But the key point is that your regression sum of squares in this case is equal to your total sum of squares. Because RSS is 0. So where am I going with all of this? Well, if you write up regression sum of squares over TSS, that is nothing more than R squared. So for the second case, where regression sum of squares is equal to total sum of squares, everything you can predict from regression is equal to your total sum of squares that you started off with, means your R squared is equal to 1. And back to the first case where we had 0 regression sum of squares, where this numerator regression sum of squares was 0, it doesn't matter what the total sum of squares is, R squared is going to be 0. So that definition for R squared is this ratio from the table. We'll take a look at a different definition for R squared now. And maybe ignore this, but we'll come back to this in the second class. But is everyone clear on those two extreme cases? All your regression models are going to be somewhere in between those two extremes. So, yeah, just a summary over there. The null model is that ratio is 0, and for perfect prediction, that ratio is 1. Okay, let's take a look at a bit what R squared is. So R squared is, as I said, is that ratio. The numerator, the regression sum of squares, is the variance we can explain. So y hat minus y bar. Whereas the denominator is y minus y bar. So all of the numerator's our baseline is always y bar. But the numerator is what we can predict, minus y bar. And the denominator is our raw data minus y bar. So the ratio is always less than 1. And you can interpret it also, if you want, you can rewrite it this way. But I'm not going to go into this interpretation. But I'm just going to stick with the interpretation of regression sum of squares over total sum of squares. But some of you may, there's a nice interpretation of this one also. But you can do that. If you can do the first one, you can do that. So R squared of 0, we've shown, that requires that the predictions must just be our y bar, whatever y bar is. We're just predicting a flat line, whereas r squared equals 1 means that we can predict without error. A different interpretation of r squared comes from the correlation coefficient that we looked at right at the beginning of the class. So we had r of xy is the covariance of xy divided by the variance of x times the variance of y. We take the square root of that. R, we showed, was a value between minus 1 and plus 1. And then r squared is just the square of that. So you can also interpret r squared as the correlation between two variables. but you've taken the sign information away and you've squared it up, which is unhelpful, actually, if you take away the sign information, because it would be nice from R squared, you don't get the feeling whether this is a positive correlation or a negative correlation. But the reason for doing that is because when we deal with multiple x's, you can't deal with the sign information anymore. But for single x, actually, it would be much nicer to report the r, the lowercase r, the correlation coefficient, because you actually get some of the sign, the meaning of the sign there. But that's just an aside issue. What you need to remember here is that r squared is just the square of the correlation coefficient. So we looked at earlier those correlation coefficients. Sorry, we looked at those correlations of the quadratic and the, what's a strongly positive correlation, a strong negative correlation earlier on. Just take that number and square it. It gives you r squared. So it's a number between these two extremes. We've looked at the extreme of 0, we've looked at the extreme of 1. Now, just some words on r squared. I don't like r squared too much. It's actually abused quite a lot in industry and in journal publications and other places. You see R squared is very widely quoted, but it's actually pretty useless. It's only a good measure of how your model works for the current data set. It's got absolutely no bearing on how the model will perform in the future. None at all. And that's usually why we're building these models. You're building a model usually for one of two reasons. To learn about your data. So you want to learn about your process. You want to learn about the slope coefficient and its relationship. If you change one variable, how the other variable changes. But when you want to learn about your process, you don't want to learn just about the data set that you have to build at that time. You also want to infer about future process operation, not just the data that you use to build the model from right there. That's one way you would use your model, is for that. And then the other way is to make predictions. So the first way is you learn from your model by looking at D1 and D0, and you interpret what those are. That's learning from your data. The second one is to predict using your model. So you can use your model in the future on new data. Both of those cases, you're implying future use of the data, and future use of the model. But R squared is just showing you how well your model coefficients work on that set of data you use for the model. It's got no bearing on how well the model will work in the future. So when someone says the R squared is really high at 90%, and people go, wow, that's a great model, let's put it online, let's make predictions. No, you have to check the model first. Or conversely, when people say there's no R squared, that model's a waste of time, we need to figure out something different, maybe the anomaly transformation, there's no relationship between these variables because R squared is low, that's equally garbage. So we'll take a look at some better alternatives later on in the course. But just to emphasize here that goodness of a model is much better assessed by using your engineering judgment with the plot data, and you look at the model parameters. So superimpose the model on the data that you've used, and preferably this, you do the second case. You use new testing data to verify the model performance. By that, I mean is you keep aside, like we did for the control charts, you have, kind of have a phase one and a phase two. We don't strictly speak about phase one and phase two when we build models like this, but you can use the same idea. You use 500 data points to build your model, and then you use the other 1,500 data points to test your model. That's the much better way of doing it. And then if you can't do that, you'll introduce this tool for cost validation later on in the course. That's a kind of a makeshift way to have a training set and a testing set. But using a training and testing set is the gold standard. Every model that actually has to be used in practice, you're much better off by having a testing data set. And then I just also make this note here that you can arbitrarily inflate R squared by just adding terms to your model. We'll look at that in the next class. But since you can inflate R squared arbitrarily that way, so people have introduced this concept of the adjusted R squared, where you divide through by k. So k is the number of terms in your model. We're just dealing with two in this case. But in the next class, we'll see that you can make r squared big by just adding more terms. Well, then people say, well, no, I kind of see what you're doing here. So they divide through by k to normalize to that. So there's the concept of an adjusted r squared. And you'll see that in the software as well. Okay, so far, how are people feeling about this stuff? I see a few people are, this is obviously not new to them, and a few people are pretty confused. So I'm kind of, I guess, got a normal distribution. we'll move on. You guys want to take like a 5-minute break to just stretch your legs? Yeah, okay. This next section that we'll end off with today is we'll look at the confidence interval for P0 and P1. I want to just get to the point where we can look at the confidence intervals in two parameters and in the software output so we can be comfortable with using the R software to interpret the R software. So like I said before, we've made no assumptions on our data. We were able to calculate the V0 and the V1 parameters, and we can make predictions from the model without any assumptions on what the data would look like. But to make these confidence intervals, we need to start making a few assumptions. And I'm going to go through the assumptions pretty quickly, not because I'm taking them lightly, but we're going to come back to them in the next class, where we're specifically focusing on the assumptions and when they break down. But for now, I'm just going to state the assumptions, and from that we're able to derive confidence. So the first assumption we make is that the model is linear. By that I mean any error in E gets transmitted straight through to Y. Because it's a linear model, we know V0 equals the population parameter, V1 is also a known population parameter, and X1 is fixed. So none of those terms have error. So an error in Y is equal to an error in E. That's what the first assumption says. The model is linear, so all our error gets transmitted straight over to Y. The second assumption is that your variance is constant at any level in the model. In particular, yeah, I've shown kind of a three plot where we're showing X and Y on the horizontal axis, and vertically I'm showing the probability distribution of the Y. So we're looking at Y has the same variance, the same width of that histogram, or of that distribution, at high levels of X and of low levels of X. This variance is constant at all levels of X, is what the constant variance assumption implies. Thirdly, we're assuming that our errors are normally distributed, and that's pretty important, but it's also the easiest one to check. So in practice, we're not always certain that that's true, but you can easily check the cube you've got. So here I've shown an example where we're progressing Y onto X, and it looks pretty nice, the regression line. But then when you plot the residuals up, you can see there's a slightly non-normal tail at the tempo of X. But it's easy to verify that assumption. The fourth assumption is actually often violated in practice, and it says that the errors are independent of each other. So if you take measuring your data, each data point has an independent error of the next. And that's often not the case in engineering processes, because our processes move pretty slowly, there's high degree of order correlation, and so those errors are correlated with each other as well. And you'll see that when you plot the residuals of time, if that assumption were true, the residuals would be evenly spread above and below. If there we see that periods of time when the residuals are consistently positive, then there's periods of time when the residuals are consistently negative. You notice you can't see that phenomenon in the raw data, in the plot of X against Y, but you only see that when you plot residuals against time. We'll come back to that in the second class on this topic. The fifth assumption is that your X is a fixed. We assume that already, and that they're independent of the error. And the last assumption is that our y's are also independent of each other. So if you can make those six assumptions, and some of them are pretty strong, you can create confidence intervals for B0 and B1. Now, like I said, I've glossed over those assumptions. I'll come back and look at them in much more detail in the next class. But for now, I just want to state them up front and then use them to derive confidence intervals. Now, we should be able to do confidence intervals in the sleep by now, because we've seen it so many times. The general principle is to say, I want a confidence interval for a certain parameter. Well, the way you do that is you need an assumption of how that parameter is distributed. So B0 here is distributed normally, for example, and mean of B0 is the true population with a certain variance. And the same for B1. B1 is normally distributed with the mean of beta1 plus a certain variance. What does that mean? It says every time you take a data set from the same system, so you have a system where beta0 and beta1 are present, you take a subset of data, and you calculate B0 and you calculate B1. You repeat that another time. You calculate another B0 and another B1. You keep doing that a few times, you're going to get a distribution of Bs and a distribution of B1. Those Bs, B0 and B1, will be distributed according to those populations shown to you there. Then you know, to construct a confidence interval, you calculate a Z, and then you unpack that Z value on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side, and you can get a confidence interval. So that's a standard approach. But you notice that there's one uncertainty here, and that's, what is this variance term? What is the variance of beta0, and what is the variance of beta1? If you know those, or you can estimate that, then you can use your t-distribution and unpack your confidence interval. So that's our objective. Now, the details are pretty hairy. If you look through any textbook, there's usually 5-6 lines of pretty complicated use of those 6 assumptions I stated. And if you're really interested, you can go through the references I mentioned in the notes on page 16 and 17. And I recommend you do, actually, because it's a good way for you to understand why each of those assumptions are required. But at the end of it all, you'll come to this definition. Now let's look at the definition of B1 first. So the variance of B1 is the standard error. So that's a term we saw just before the break. The standard error is that average residual size, standard deviation of the residual. So the standard error squared is the variance of your residuals divided by this denominator, x minus x bar. So take all your data, so say you have 20 data points, and for each one of them, subtract the mean and get the sum of squares. That's the variance of B1. So my question here is, apart from the numerator, if you wanted to make the variance of B1 smaller, it's almost always more desirable to have a small variance. That's usually why we calculate the variance. How can you make that variance term smaller? So ignore the numerator, ignore the standard error. From the denominator, how can you make the variance of your parameter estimate, B1, so that's your slope coefficient, the variability of the slope coefficient, how can you make that variance smaller? As a practical case, you'll see this leading in to where I had the earlier, say you want to measure let's not call it K, let's just stick with B0, but in reactor design you'll call it K, your rate constant. But let's say you plotted a graph where your rate constant is the slope, B1. You want a confidence interval for that slope. Now, you can say, at the end get a value of, say, 0.5 to 1.1. That would be your confidence interval for your rate coefficient. The width of this confidence interval is related to the variance of B1. If you can make this variance smaller, you can pull this confidence interval in tighter, and you can have a more certain estimate of your rate coefficient. And that's desirable if you're designing a reactor, and you don't need to oversize your reactor, because when you design your reactor, you usually design for the worst case. You're going to design for the lowest extreme or the highest extreme. Now, if you want to pull that parameter in, you need to decrease the variance of B1. How can you do that in practice? Right, so what that's J is a counter that goes from 1 up to N. So by increasing J, you're saying
take more data.
So measure, take more measurements. Okay, so that's great. And that makes intuitive sense. The more data we use to fit B0 and B1, the more certain we're going to be of those parameters. So that's an intuitive answer. That's great. Which other way can you decrease the variance?
Use a wider range of x.
Exactly. So around x bar, when you're collecting your data, requires you to move your process far away from the mean. So operate at the low extreme and at the high extreme. So by doing both those things, operating at more extreme points and by collecting more data, you can reduce the variability or the uncertainty of your slope. So those are exactly what it says. They use more samples and samples further away from you. Of course, you can also reduce that variance by decreasing the numerator, but that's often not possible because the standard error, the residual error, is y minus y hat. You can't really change much on that other than making sure that you correctly assume the model is linear. Remember we said the residuals are a function of whether your model truly is linear. If your model is truly non-linear, your residuals are going to be larger. And by your measurement error, so when you measure y, if you've got lots of measurement error in that y, it's just going to get lumped into e as well. So usually you can't do much about the numerator, but the denominator you can definitely do something about. Okay. The variance of B0 is similar. It's still a function of the standard error, but then it's got this correction term here. 1 over n plus the mean of your x squared divided by that same denominator term we saw earlier. In fact, that denominator term is nothing more than the variance of your data, x minus x bar squared. So that denominator is the variance of x. Okay, so given that for the variance of B0 and the variance of B1, I've summarized them for you over here. There's those two equations, and then I've also summarized standard error. So the approach is you fit your data, calculate B0 and B1, calculate your residuals. Once you have your residuals, you can take the sum of squares divided by nk, and you get your standard error. Once you have your standard error, you can then work backwards and get the variance for B1. So standard error squared divided by x minus x bar squared, in other words, the variance of x, that gives you your standard error for B1. Then to get your standard error for B0, the only thing you need in addition is your mean of x squared and the capital N, the number of data points. Okay, so those are straightforward to calculate. Then we're now in a position to calculate, finally, our confidence interval. So recall, the z value is, you say, b0 minus the population divided by the standard deviation. That's a standard terminology we explored in previous classes. And you set that in between the critical values of from the t-distribution. Okay? When you unpack that, you can get your confidence interval for B0. And you can unpack the same confidence interval for beta 1. The only note I make here is that we use the t-distribution because we don't know this denominator, the population value. So remember I said that earlier, let's just take a look at the case for B1. It said B1 comes from a normal distribution with mean of beta 1 and variance of beta 1. Okay. We went on to show that the variance of beta 1 can be approximated by the standard error squared of beta 1, of b1. Okay, I should write here this is approximately the case, because we don't know the true variance of beta 1. We can only approximate by that standard error, which we I didn't derive, but I'm just stating it over here. So then we can calculate the z, and z is equal to b1 minus beta 1 divided by the square root of the variance of beta 1. Okay? So in other words, the standard error, rather than the standard error squared. So just divide by the standard error. And that needs to lie between the upper and lower critical limit from the t distribution. And we have to use the t distribution because we don't know this variance. We're approximating the variance. So you know from the previous class moment, we're approximating the variance for the standard deviation. You move from the normal distribution to the t distribution. How many degrees of freedom in the t distribution?
N minus k.
K is 2 in this case. Perfect. Okay. So, do this example quick, and then we'll wrap up by looking at some software. This is this previous case that we looked at earlier, where we had B0 of 3 and B1 of 0.5. I've already calculated the standard error. How did I do that? Well, in R, you can say, let my predictions equal B0 times B0 plus x times B1. So in R, it will multiply that vector x by B1. So this x is a vector. That means that predictions is a vector. And I've shown you what the predictions look like. They look like that. You can compare that back into that data table in your notes for y and compare how close the predictions are to the actual y. But to calculate the error vector, then you say ry minus predictions is error. And then I notice there's a glitch here in my overheads. I don't think it's in the notes, but that should be error. Maybe this. Error split at 2. So you raise error to the power of 2, and you calculate the square root of the sum of the two. So that's how you calculate standard error. I'm just using the formula in your notes. And I'm also giving you that the CT value at the 95 confidence is 2.26. So from all of that, calculate the confidence interval for B, for beta 0 and beta 1. 2 minutes. It's really quick and easy. It's 5 marks in the test. So, as most of you have probably come to this point where you calculate the standard error for B1 first. So you take that standard error I gave, make sure that it's the correct form. I think I gave standard error. So you need to first square that to get standard error squared. Then divide by the variance of the x, which is 110. And you can do the same procedure for the standard error for B0. Again, calculate the limit of x bar. So I believe x bar was 9, so x bar squared is 81. Divide by the variance of 110 plus 1 over 11. 10 is 11. And then multiply by s in squared. Okay, so that's just pure mechanics, but I just wanted to get a feeling for where all these numbers are coming from. Yeah, so standard error squared for B1, I calculated as 0.13, and the standard error for B0 is 1.26. Substituting that into the formula here for the confidence interval for beta 0, you can show that beta 0 lies between 0.45 and 5.5. So your intercept is anywhere from 0.45 up to 5.5, the 95% confidence interval for your intercept. But more importantly than knowing where the confidence interval for the intercept is knowing the confidence interval for the slope parameter. Yeah, I'll come back to this one later. But more importantly is this, the standard error for beta 1. It lies between 0.23 and 0.76. So you can now get a feeling for how far that slope is. And unfortunately, this hasn't come out very clearly here in class. But the red line was the base regression. That slope is 0.5. And then I've shown here, it's very faint, but over here there's a line. It's the slope at 0.76. And over here is the shallower slope of 0.233. Notice they all pivot through this point that I've marked with an asterisk, which is actually x bar. So all these lines will always go through x bar without error. We proved that in the earlier part of today's class. But that gives you a feeling for what that confidence interval means on the slope. Your slope can lie anywhere between those two points. Even though you've calculated it as 0.5, the true value is actually a variable itself. Now, don't worry about getting these numbers down. These notes I'm going to put on the website with the numbers filled in. So you can get it there. What I want to end off in the last few parts of the course is looking at the software output. This is, I'm just jumping over a section here to finish up on time. Because we'll need this for the midterm. To calculate the model, I showed you earlier, you say assign the variable model to this output from LM. And in R, if you say summary model, it gives you much more information. Earlier on, it just gave you the intercept and the slope. But if you say summary R, it gives you a lot more. Let's break this down. You should be able to calculate pretty much every number in this output from the formulas I've shown to you today. The first piece, it just shows you what you wrote earlier on. So that's not really of interest, but it's great if you've copied and pasted this and you're referring back to it. It shows you how this is coming in. It shows you your residuals, the smallest residual, the first quartile, median, third quartile, and maximum. And you would expect your median of the residuals to be at zero. And then the minimum and maximum values you can quickly use to gauge your lowest or your worst predicted point and your highest worst predicted point. The coefficients, it gives you over here, the first column. So the word estimate, ignore that standard error belongs to the second column. So over here is estimate, it's 3 and 0.5. The standard error of the intercept is this number here, S0, SE0. So SE0, that's the standard error squared, I is 1.266. But that's what it's calculating over here for you, and giving you just the standard error of the intercept of B0 and the standard error of X. It gives you the T value. R calls it the T value, I've called it, in this course so far we've called it Z. But what that is it's B0 minus B divided by the standard error for B0. So what R calls the Z value is actually this ratio And this is the probability of seeing a T greater than that. So that's a standard confidence interval procedure. I'm going to ignore what the star codes mean. We'll come back to that later on perhaps, but I don't really want you to deal with the star codes. All I'm interested in is really to understand the standard error and the estimate, because from that you can construct the confidence interval yourself. Then lastly, it shows you the residual standard error. That is what we just called the standard error. R called it the residual standard error, but that's just SE. On 9 degrees of freedom, that's N minus K. And the multiple R squared is just R squared. That's the regression sum of squares divided by total sum of squares. R also tells you what the adjusted R squared was, and I showed that earlier. And then this last line, we'll come back to that in the next class. We'll deal with that. Okay? So without you having to calculate all those formulas yourself, you can just use the output from R and get all those same ones. But try to, at least for one regression problem, duplicate the output from R so you can understand it as well. So just one question. So this is the T value or Z value, the R calls it the T value. This is the probability of seeing the Z greater than R calls this greater than Z. Okay. Is there any other questions while you have?